This is Democracy Now!
Disgrace. There's been tremendous corruption, and we're seeking it. It's called drain the swamp.
As the impeachment inquiry into President Trump heats up and House Democrats subpoena Trump's personal lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, we host a debate on impeachment.
On an almost daily basis, Donald Trump attacks our Constitution, our democracy, and the rule of law, and he must face impeachment proceedings.
We don't dismantle corporate power. Impeachment of the president will be cosmetic, and in fact, probably exacerbate the very antagonisms and divisions that are rending apart the country.
We'll speak with Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Chris Hedges, his latest article, The Problem with Impeachment, and John Boniface, co-founder and president of Free Speech for People, one of the organizations calling for Trump's impeachment. Then we turn to the water crisis in Newark with Mayor Raz Baraka.
The plan is never altered. Filters, orthophosphate, changing the lead service line. That has always been our plan. It is our plan now. And we won't rest until every lead service line in the city is completely replaced.
All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. House Democrats have subpoenaed President Donald Trump's personal lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, seeking documents related to his work in Ukraine. Last week, Giuliani admitted on television he had urged the Ukrainian government to investigate Trump's political rival, Joe Biden. This comes as House Democrats continue to build their case for impeaching the president following a whistleblower complaint filed by an intelligence officer who was detailed to work at the White House at one point. The whistleblower complaint focused on a July 25th phone call during which Trump asked the Ukrainian president to do him a favor by investigating the actions of Democrats, including Joe Biden and his son Hunter. On Monday, the Wall Street Journal revealed Secretary of State Mike Pompeo was among the administration officials who were on the call. Meanwhile, evidence is growing that the Trump administration pressured other nations, including Australia, Britain and Italy, to take steps to help Trump politically. The New York Times reports Trump personally pressed Australia's prime minister to help Attorney General William Barr with a probe aimed at discrediting the Mueller investigation. Barr also traveled to Italy last week, where he reportedly pressed Italian officials to help his probe. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo is in Italy today. This all comes as President Trump is continuing to threaten lawmakers pushing impeachment. On Monday, Trump suggested House Intelligence Chair Adam Schiff should be arrested for treason. Trump also publicly admitted he's trying to find out the identity of the anonymous whistleblower in possible violation of whistleblower protection laws.
Well, we're trying to find out about a whistleblower. When you have a whistleblower that reports things that were incorrect.
Attorneys for the whistleblower are saying they have, quote, serious concerns for their client's safety. On Monday, Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell said the Senate would hold a trial if the House impeaches the president. Hong Kong protesters returned to the streets today as China marked the 70th anniversary of the founding of the People's Republic of China. Hong Kong police fired live ammunition at protesters for the first time since the street protests began 17 weeks ago. One protester was shot in the chest. Police also fired tear gas and water cannons while protesters were seen throwing Molotov cocktails. This comes as Reuters reports there are now up to 12,000 Chinese troops in Hong Kong, twice as many as when the protests began. Meanwhile, in Beijing, China held what's been described as one of the country's largest military parades ever to mark 70 years since Mao Zedong declared the creation of the People's Republic of China October 1st, 1949. President Xi Jinping spoke earlier today in Tiananmen Square.
On our journey forward, we must adhere to the principle of peaceful reunification in one country, two systems, maintain long-term prosperity and stability of Hong Kong and Macau, push for peaceful development of cross-strait relationships, unite all Chinese people to continue to work hard for the complete reunification of our nation.
And anti-government protests are continuing in Haiti. Much of the capital, Port-au-Prince, has been locked down for the past 2 weeks. At least four people have been shot and killed in recent days after Haitian police opened fire on protesters using live ammunition and tear gas. The protesters are demanding the resignation of Haitian President Jovenel Moïse. This is Haitian activist David Oxygen.
People are fighting and the government is repressing it. The town is on the street to dismiss Jovenel. To expel Jovenel means the solution to hunger. To dismiss Jovenel means solution to the murders in the popular neighborhoods, as we see in La Saline, Tokyo, Grand Ravine, and Fort National. Being on the street is a political battle against the system.
In Somalia, the militant group al-Shabaab is claiming responsibility for attacking a U.S. drone base and an Italian military convoy Monday. Meanwhile, Amnesty International is accusing the United States of killing three Somali civilian farmers in an airstrike in March. The U.S. claimed the strike had targeted members of al-Shabaab. Meanwhile, in Nigeria, the imprisoned journalist, former presidential candidate Omoyele Sowore, pleaded not guilty to treason and other charges Monday. He's been jailed since early August after calling for protests against Nigerian President Muhammadu Buhari. Sowore, who founded the New York-based news outlet Sahara Reporters, briefly spoke to reporters Monday before being pulled away by Nigerian security agents. To see our interview on the imprisonment of Sowore Moyele, you can go to democracynow.org. The Trump administration's blocked Cuba's health minister from attending a regional meeting of the World Health Organization in Washington. This comes as part of an increasing crackdown by the Trump administration on Cuba. Last week, the U.S. placed sanctions on former Cuban President Raul Castro, along with his children, for supporting the Venezuelan government. The United States also recently expelled two Cuban diplomats assigned to the United Nations. Meanwhile, Cuba is facing a severe fuel shortage due to crippling U.S. sanctions. New York Republican Congressmember Chris Collins has resigned. He and his son are expected to plead guilty today to accusations of insider trading involving an Australian biotech company for which Collins served on the board. Collins was the first Republican Congressmember to support Donald Trump's run for the White House. In campaign news, Democratic presidential candidate Bernie Sanders has announced he raised a massive $25 million in the third quarter. It's the biggest fundraising quarter for any Democratic candidate so far this year. Sanders now received donations from 1.4 million individuals, more than any other Democratic candidate. In news from Missouri, lawyers for a death row prisoner scheduled to be executed tonight are urging the Missouri governor to halt the execution. Lawyers warn the execution of Russell Bucklew may be, quote, especially gruesome. Bucklew has a rare condition which causes unstable, blood-filled tumors to grow in his head, neck and throat. His lawyers say the tumors may burst during the execution, causing him to possibly suffocate. In Seattle, Washington, climate protesters shut down four Chase Bank branches Monday to protest J.P. Morgan Chase's funding of the fossil fuel industry. 11 people were arrested. According to one count, J.P. Morgan Chase has loaned $196 billion to fossil fuel corporations since the signing of the Paris Agreement in 2015. In San Francisco, police arrested 37 animal rights activists Monday after they occupied a Whole Foods market for more than 3 hours. The group, Direct Action Everywhere, accused Whole Foods and its parent company, Amazon, of purchasing food from factory farms where criminal animal abuse has been exposed. During the protests, activists erected a 15-foot-tall cutout of Amazon CEO Jeff Bezos' head on top of the store's roof. California Governor Gavin Newsom has signed the nation's first law to allow for college athletes to be paid for endorsement deals and to hire agents. The law is set to go into effect 2023. In a statement, Governor Newsom said, quote, "Colleges and universities reap billions from these student-athletes' sacrifices and success, but block them from earning a single dollar. That's a bankrupt model, one that puts institutions ahead of the students they're supposed to serve," he said. And this week marks the 100th anniversary of the Elaine massacre, when white vigilantes in Arkansas massacred hundreds of African Americans in one of the deadliest incidents of racial violence in the nation's history. The massacre began after black sharecroppers attempted to organize with the Progressive Farmers and Household Union of America to demand higher pay for cotton. A new memorial to the victims of the massacre was recently unveiled in the county seat of Helena, Arkansas. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman.
And I'm Juan Gonzalez. Welcome to all of our listeners and viewers across the country and around the world. We begin today's show with the growing impeachment inquiry into President Donald Trump. House Democrats subpoenaed Trump's personal lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, on Monday, seeking documents related to his work in the Ukraine. Last week, Giuliani admitted on television that he had urged the Ukrainian government to investigate Trump's political rival, Joe Biden. This comes as House Democrats continue to build their case for impeaching the president following a whistleblower complaint filed by an intelligence officer who was detailed to work at the White House at one point. The whistleblower complaint focused on a phone call in which Trump asked the Ukrainian president to do him a, quote, favor by investigating the actions of Democrats, including Joe Biden and his son Hunter. On Monday, The Wall Street Journal revealed that Secretary of State Mike Pompeo was among the administration officials who were on the controversial July 25th phone call. Meanwhile, evidence is growing that the Trump administration also pressured other nations, including Australia and Italy, to take steps to help Trump politically. The New York Times reports Trump personally pressed Australia's prime minister to help Attorney General William Barr with his review of the origins of the Mueller probe. Barr also traveled to Italy last week, where he reportedly pressed Italian officials to help his probe.
President Trump is continuing to threaten lawmakers pushing impeachment. On Monday, Trump suggested House Intelligence Chair Adam Schiff should be arrested for treason.
Adam Schiff made up a phony call, and he read it to Congress, and he read it to the people of the United States. And it's a disgrace. This whole thing is a disgrace. There's been tremendous corruption, and we're seeking it. It's called Drain the Swamp.
Trump also publicly admitted he's trying to find out the identity of the anonymous whistleblower in possible violation of whistleblower protection laws.
Well, we're trying to find out about a whistleblower. When you have a whistleblower that reports things that were incorrect.
In a series of tweets over the weekend, President Trump accused the unnamed whistleblower of spying on the president, promising, quote, big consequences. He also threatened civil war if impeachment proceedings move forward. 2020 presidential hopeful Senator Kamala Harris tweeted Monday, look, let's be honest, real Donald Trump's Twitter account should be suspended. Well, for more, we host a debate on impeachment. Joining us here in New York City are two guests. John Boniface is an attorney and political activist specializing in constitutional law and voting rights. He's the co-founder and president of Free Speech for People, one of the organizations calling for Trump's impeachment. John Boniface is the co-author with Ron Fine and Ben Clements of The Constitution Demands It, the case for the impeachment of Donald Trump. Chris Hedges is also with us. He's a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist, award-winning author and activist, columnist for the news website Truthdig. His latest article is headlined, The Problem with Impeachment. He's written numerous books, including most recently, America, The Farewell Tour. We welcome you both to Democracy Now! John Boniface, let's begin with you. Why do you feel Donald Trump should be impeached?
Donald Trump is a threat to our republic. He defies the Constitution and the rule of law almost on a daily basis. And really, from the moment he took the oath of office, he showed this disregard for the Constitution, refusing to divest from his business interests all over the world and directly colliding with the anti-corruption provisions of the Constitution, the Foreign and Domestic Emoluments Clauses. But unfortunately, the impeachable offenses did not stop there. He has been repeatedly abusing his power and abusing the oath of office, and he must face impeachment proceedings.
And yet the House is currently in its inquiry looking basically at one issue, what happened with the phone call in Ukraine. And Chris Hedges, you've said that the fatal mistake that Trump made is trying to take down a fellow member of the ruling elite. Could you?
Well, it reminds me of the Watergate hearings, where the activities that were carried out by the Nixon White House against the Democratic headquarters in Watergate were directed at the elites. All of those activities had been carried out before, including break-ins into Daniel Ellsberg's psychiatrist's office against anti-war activists. But it's when those activities were targeted at the elite. And I think that's exactly what we've seen. And that's what's triggered such a reaction, including from Pelosi, who up until now has been very reluctant to carry out impeachment. But what they've done, or what the Trump White House has done, is target the favored nominee by the Democratic donor class.
That's not necessarily an argument to not proceed with impeachment proceedings. It's an argument to expand the scope of the impeachment inquiry to cover all of his Donald Trump's impeachable offenses, from obstruction of justice, from giving aid and comfort to white supremacists and neo-Nazis, racist abuses of power, placing children and their families in imprisonment unconstitutionally at the southern border. All of the impeachable offenses need to be covered by these impeachment proceedings, not just the Ukraine scandal.
Well, yeah, I agree with that. And I'm not against impeachment. The problem is that and you use the phrase rule of law. From the very moment Trump took office, he was violating the Emoluments Clause. Very clear evidence that he attempted to obstruct justice during the Mueller investigation, inciting violence and racism, using taxes to punish people he considered political opponents, Jeff Bezos in particular, Amazon. Yes, it's all there. But what has been disturbing for me is the shredding of the rule of law, the inability on the part of the ruling elites on both sides of the aisle to stand up for the rule of law until now. And that gets to the much deeper issue that there are essentially—we live in a two-tiered legal system where poverty has been criminalized. We live in a city where Eric Garner was strangled to death by New York City police for allegedly selling loose cigarettes, which he wasn't on the day he was killed. He was, in fact, not doing anything. And then Wall Street, which has essentially rewritten the rules to—and so my worry about impeachment, which I'm not against impeachment, is that people see it as a panacea. I think many in the Democratic Party, in particular in the liberal class, have personalized our problems in the figure of Donald Trump. And, in fact, the malaise runs much deeper. This is what I spent the last 2 years doing in my book, America, the Farewell Tour. It is the rupturing of what the sociologist Emile Durkheim calls these social bonds. That's where you get the term anomie. The disenfranchisement of well over half the country, the inability of them to actualize themselves, and acting out in self-destructive pathologies, whether that's hate groups, the opioid crisis, gambling, sexual sadism, etc. And so go ahead with impeachment, but if we don't begin to address the underlying malaise and disenfranchisement and rage and legitimate rage on the part of the white working class, however much Trump lies, and of course he lies like he breathes, the Clintons also lied in far more damaging ways to the working class and in particular the white working class than Donald Trump. And we know from polls that right before the election in 2016, you had 55% of those who said they were voting for Trump. It was because they disliked Hillary Clinton. Only 44%. So Trump was kind of weaponized. You know, he was the middle finger to the establishment. He was weaponized against the man. If we don't begin to deal with those issues, impeachment itself will rent the fabric of American society further into antagonistic tribes, and we have to acknowledge the fact we are a country awash in weapons, 300 million weapons, mass shootings on the average of one a day. And we almost saw with Cesar Sayoc the complete decapitation of the Democratic Party with pipe bombs. That's the territory we're headed towards.
I wanted to go to Texas Congressmember Al Green. He's the first one to have called for impeachment several years ago. On Monday, he tweeted, "Mr. President, maliciously attacking a whistleblower and promoting civil unrest to avoid impeachment won't save you. You should have already been impeached for your bigotry, corruption and disloyalty to our country. Hashtag Civil War II. Hashtag impeach now." Democracy Now! Spoke to Congressmember Green last week.
We have a responsibility to the country and to the future. The future is going to be one that will allow a president to assume that there are no guardrails if we don't act now. We have to demonstrate that Congress will honor the Constitution and that we have principle that we will place above politics, that we will place the people above our political parties. And I think that if we do this, we will consider democracy and not Democrats. We will consider the Republic and not Republicans.
Houston Congressmember Al Green was speaking just after Nancy Pelosi had announced that the impeachment inquiry is going to go forward, something he has called for several years. But John Boniface, as a lawyer, can you explain, now they're going after Trump for Ukraine and for pressuring the Ukrainian president to investigate his political rival, Joe Biden and his son Hunter. How does this expand? I mean, we know the same thing happened with Clinton. It started with Whitewater, but it ended up around his relationship with an intern.
Well, I think we have to first look at why Congress has started these impeachment proceedings. The narrative right now among conventional thinkers is it started because of the explosive evidence that emerged from the Ukraine scandal. But in fact, that's not really true. For many months, there's been a people's movement building demanding impeachment proceedings along all the impeachable offenses that this president has already committed. And this was the last straw. This evidence coming from this scandal finally pushed Congress, those who were sitting on the fence, including Speaker Pelosi, to do the right thing and start the impeachment inquiry, which is why we should not let up now with this movement. We need to pressure members of Congress to expand the scope, to include the very racist abuses of power Congressman Green has talked about, the emoluments violations, the obstruction of justice, and so forth. I don't disagree with Chris that we have a two-tiered judicial system here, but that doesn't mean we don't hold this president accountable for his abuses of power that have begun from the moment he took the oath of office.
We're going to break and then come back to this discussion. John Boniface, attorney and political activist. He is for impeachment. He's written a book on it. Chris Hedges, Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist, award-winning author and activist. Questioning, is impeachment the way to go now? This is Democracy Now! We'll be back with them in a minute, and then we'll be joined by the mayor of Newark, Raz Baraka. Stay with us. Jesse Norman and the New York Philharmonic. The legendary opera singer died Monday at the age of 74. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.
Well, we're continuing our debate on the impeachment of President Donald Trump with John Boniface, attorney and political activist, and Chris Hedges, Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist, award-winning author and activist. Chris, I wanted to ask you if we could go a little deeper into what's going on here. You mentioned this whole issue of the potential for even deeper conflict in the United States. But I want to ask you, as someone who has studied these systems at length over many years, are we reaching the point where capitalist democracy has reached its limits? We're seeing in many countries around the world total paralysis of governments. In Britain, Peru, the president just recently suspended the National Assembly. The Assembly is refusing to listen to his orders. And here in the United States, we're seeing a virtual paralysis of our government as a result of this response to an authoritarian dictator. Is it the reality that democracy, given the huge polarization of wealth, has reached its limits in what it can accomplish?
Well, I think democracy has been destroyed by global capitalism, that we have the facade of democracy. Lobbyists write our rules. Supreme Court inverts constitutional rights. The whole idea that unlimited corporate cash is defined by our Supreme Court as the right to petition the government or a form of free speech. Speech is an inversion of constitutional rights. The fact that we are the most spied upon, watched, monitored population in human history, and I covered the Stasi state in East Germany, and I think that that is the far more grave consequence of unfettered or unregulated capitalism, which, as Karl Marx correctly pointed out, is a revolutionary force. So, yes, Juan, I think you hit on a very important point. And so the capitalist class essentially, which has orchestrated the largest transference of wealth globally upwards in human history, is determined to beat back even, I would call them, kind of moderate figures like Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders, essentially New Deal Democrats, and they will turn to support demagogues like Trump, like Boris Johnson, Orban, etc., that we are seeing arise, rather than carry out policies that will ameliorate the vast disparity in power and wealth. And I was reading the New York Times on the way in here, and they were writing that there was an article about Elizabeth Warren and how the donor class within the Democratic Party is, which of course backs Joe Biden, which gets back to the whole reaction, I think, by the Democratic leadership over this issue of Ukraine, that they've made it very clear that they will swing to Trump. Rather than support, in particular, Warren or Sanders. And so, yes, there is a complete breakdown within the democratic institutions that once made piecemeal and incremental reform possible. And this just goes all the way back to Weimar, and I covered the Yugoslavia, that when there is that societal breakdown, the capitalist class, they do find a figure like Trump vulgar and repugnant, but they will back him as opposed to I would even call them political moderates like Warren or Sanders, who talk about righting the gross inequality in terms of power and in terms of economics that has taken place.
And John Bonifaz, what about this Trump retweeting the statements of this extremist minister, Pentecostal minister from Texas, that civil war may be possible if people try to impeach Trump? What about this issue that there are people on the right in America that are demonstrably willing to fight to keep Trump in power?
So, first of all, Harvard Law Professor John Coates responded yesterday to that tweet, saying that's a separate independent ground now for impeachment proceedings for the president to retweet that kind of statement and try to incite violence. But we also not be thinking somehow that this president has not already done that kind of incitement of violence. He has. The El Paso shooter cited his rhetoric in regards to that terrible mass shooting. And this president will continue to engage in destructive behavior and abuses of power, regardless of whether or not we are somehow claiming that he should be held accountable during the election. That's why impeachment needs to move forward, because he's a direct and serious threat to our republic today. And that's why the framers placed the impeachment power in the Constitution. The other point I would make here is that we cannot cower to these threats of violence by saying that mob rule gets to rule the day. We have to lift up the Constitution and the promise that no one is above the law, not even the President of the United States.
So this impeachment proceeding is moving fast. You have at least the plan of the House Intelligence Committee next week to bring in the former U.S. ambassador to Ukraine, who was pushed out, Marie Yovanovitch. And then on Thursday, Kurt Volker, the former U.S. special envoy to Ukraine, who just quit, and Michael Atkinson, the intelligence inspector general, who will testify on Friday. Then also on Friday, subpoena deadlines for Mike Pompeo, who's in Italy right now, in October. Now, this month, Rudy Giuliani also has been subpoenaed. So the process of how this will work. On Monday, Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell told CNBC the Senate would have no choice but to take up Trump's impeachment if the House charges the president.
If the Senate rule related to impeachment that would take 67 votes to change. So I would have no choice but to take it up. How long you're on it is a whole different matter, but I would have no choice but to take it up, so, based on a Senate rule on impeachment.
So that's Senator Mitch McConnell, Senate Majority Leader. What does that look like? I mean, just you've studied the impeachment process. So it goes from the House to the Senate. What does a trial look like? John Roberts, the Chief Justice, would preside over it?
Yes, he would preside, and the Senate would need to hear from the House. There would be House managers who present the articles of impeachment with the evidence to the Senate, and the Senate sits as the jury in this instance. And I think it's significant that Senator McConnell has made this statement because he, of course, is facing re-election, or potentially not, in the state of Kentucky. And he knows, he sees where the public is moving on this. We've already seen a huge spike just in the last week in terms of public support for this impeachment inquiry. CBS News had 55% of the public supporting this. So senators, both Republican and Democratic, are going to need to cast their vote on this historic question and decide where they stand. And they will face consequences if they do not uphold the Constitution.
Chris Hedges, I wanted you to respond to New York Congressmember Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, who told reporters Friday it would be much worse if Congress doesn't move forward with impeachment proceedings.
What we're seeing with these developments from Ukraine are extremely serious. And whether, you know, we can't ask ourselves about whether we move too slow or too quickly. We have to ask ourselves what we're doing right now. The president has committed several impeachable offenses. He himself, what he has admitted to, is already impeachable, regardless of future developments. What he has already admitted to is an impeachable offense, among others. I anticipate, and I believe there'll be discussion as to whether, when we draft or when the judiciary examines the question on filing potential articles of impeachment, what those articles will include. I think we have to hold this president accountable, and we have to protect our democracy. And I believe that we'll be doing so right now.
So Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez was a major force in pushing House Speaker Nancy Pelosi to conduct an impeachment inquiry.
Well, I'm not against impeachment. The problem is impeachment divorced from confronting the decay and disintegration of our democratic institutions and the vast social inequality that has fed the rage on the part of the white working class. Will potentially make things worse. I mean, I think that, yes, we do have to honor, and we should have 2.5 years ago begun to honor the rule of law. But, you know, there are millions of Trump supporters who look at him as primarily a cult figure, who see in his power an extension of their own power, a way to compensate for their own sense of disempowerment. And it's very clear that they will react. They already have attempted to react with violence. Ocasio-Cortez herself has been the recipient of death threats. And this violence against her has been stoked by the president. And so my big fear is that somehow people think that impeachment is the panacea. Removing Trump, and, you know, Noam Chomsky probably correctly points out that, you know, Pence will be worse because he comes out of the community of Christian fascists. I speak as a seminary graduate. They're heretics. And so it is very dangerous for those figures who—
Heretics?
Jesus didn't come to bless the dropping of iron fragmentation bombs across the Middle East, or bless the white race above other race, or hold up America. I mean, this is heretical, and the failure on the liberal church to call out these people for who they are and give them religious legitimacy, that's another show, I think has been one of perhaps the greatest failing of the liberal church, which I come out of. And so our problems are far more severe. Trump is the product. He's what's vomited up from a failed democracy, in the same way that I saw figures like Radovan Karadzic or Slobodan Milosevic vomited up from the failed democracy of Yugoslavia and go back to Weimar and the Nazis. So we have to begin to address the fundamental root causes that have created the political crisis and the economic crisis, the social and even cultural crisis that we are in. And if we don't,
re-knit those social bonds. If we don't confront that crisis, impeachment may very well pour gasoline on the growing antagonisms and violence that is besetting this country.
And so, John Bonifaz, I wanted to ask you, though, if Nancy Pelosi's decision to move forward on impeachment inquiry on this issue of the phone conversation with the Ukrainian—with Ukraine's president, I feel like I'm in Casablanca. Surprise, there's gambling at this establishment, right? I mean, isn't the ability of presidents of the United States to pressure foreign leaders to do what they want sort of in part of the process of how the United States wields power? Or is it just the situation here that the president did it directly himself rather than have one of his minions exert the pressure?
No, the issue is that he solicited foreign interference to help his election campaign, not that he solicited pressure or forced a country to do something that he claims was for the U.S. foreign policy.
But that itself has happened. Didn't the Reagan administration convince Iran to hold back the release of Ronald Reagan's people convinced Iran to hold back the release of the Iranian hostages until the president was inaugurated?
There's no question there's a history of impeachable offenses being committed by other administrations. But I do want to come back to this idea that impeachment is a panacea. No one in the impeachment movement, and this has been a people's movement pressuring for impeachment proceedings, no one is suggesting it's a panacea. What is required is that Congress do its job and hold this president accountable for his abuses of power. But that doesn't mean we can't walk and chew gum at the same time. Free speech for people has been around for 10 years. We've been taking on big money in politics and corruption in government, and we will continue to do that in the fight for our democracy. But we did not believe we could be true to that mandate without also taking on the unprecedented corruption of this presidency. And I do want to add, you know, because this is a people's movement, the pressure needs to continue and will continue on Congress to expand the scope of its inquiry beyond the Ukraine scandal. On October 13th, there will be a national day of action called by one of our organizational allies, By the People, for marches all across the country. Already a number of marches have been organized on the eve of Congress returning from its recess. People can find out more about that by going to buythepppl.us and impeachnow.org. But this is why we are where we are today, is because people have demanded this, millions of people all over the country, that Congress do its job and uphold the Constitution.
Well, of course, we'll continue discussions like these, and I thank you so much for being with us. John Bonifaz, attorney, political activist, co-founder, president of Free Speech for People, one of the organizations calling for Trump's impeachment. John Bonifaz is co-author of The Constitution Demands It, The Case for the Impeachment of Donald Trump, and Chris Hedges, formerly with The New York Times, a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist, award-winning author, activist, columnist for the news website Truthdig. His latest article, The Problem with Impeachment. He's written numerous books. His last, America, The Farewell Tour. When we come back, we turn to the water crisis in Newark with Mayor Raz Baraka. Stay with us. Thank you. The Healers by the late Randy Weston, performing on Democracy Now! In 2012. On Sunday, Lafayette Avenue in Brooklyn, New York, where he lived, was co-named Randy Weston Way. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.
Well, we end today's show with the water crisis in Newark, New Jersey, where city officials recently announced thousands of water filters handed out to residents have significantly reduced lead in drinking water to safe levels. Lead contamination has plagued the city for years. In 2017, more than 13% of New Jersey children had elevated lead levels in Newark, despite just 3.8% of the state's children living there. But lead levels spiked even higher in 2019. Over the summer, the Natural Resources Defense Council filed a lawsuit against Newark, accusing it of violating federal safe drinking water laws. The crisis came to a head last month following revelations that water filters distributed to residents may not have been effective. In August, the Environmental Protection Agency ordered Newark officials to distribute bottled water to 15,000 residents, saying water filters did not fully shield thousands of homes from lead exposure. Newark residents waited in line for hours to receive their water. The city then stopped handing out the bottles after discovering many of them had exceeded their best-by date. Last week, Newark Mayor Roz Baraka reassured residents the water filters are now working and removing lead below the federal action level.
I am happy, not only for the hundreds of thousands of residents of the city or the 18,000 homes that are affected or the 14,000 in the Pequannock that are affected by this. I'm happy because the filter that I use in my home may also be working. So it is good news that 97% of those filters work upon coming out of the tap, no matter what, and 99% if you flush the water.
Meanwhile, New Jersey officials have signed off on a $120 million bond with Essex County to fast-track the replacement of thousands of contaminated pipes in the city in the next 2 years to 30 months. New Jersey Governor Phil Murphy said the state would spend $1 million on a community assistance program to help Newark residents install water filters in their homes and collect water samples for additional testing. But New Jersey's political leaders are facing mounting criticism for their handling of the water crisis. Advocates say the city downplayed the severity of the problem for years and has been slow on solutions, comparing Newark's water crisis to Flint, Michigan. Newark's the largest city in New Jersey, with nearly 300,000 residents. Its water crisis primarily affects its low-income and Black community. Tomorrow, that's Wednesday, Newark Mayor Roz Baraka will hold a State of the Water Town Hall meeting. Well, for more, we are joined by Mayor Roz Baraka. He was born and raised in Newark, represented the city's South Ward from 2010 until his election as mayor. Mayor Baraka is a longtime educator, credited with turning around Newark Central High School as principal from 2007 to 2014. His father, the late Amiri Baraka, was a global activist and noted poet. Newark Mayor Roz Baraka, welcome back to Democracy Now! It's great to have you with us.
Glad to be here.
So, well, let's get right to it. There were lead excesses 2 years ago and every quarter since. The concern is that you stated that the water was safe when your data clearly showed it wasn't. It may have been clean at the source, but when the residents drank it, it wasn't. Why the reinsurances? Why did you put on the city website, the water is safe to drink?
Well, that has been the story that people have been using since the beginning. I think it's a little disingenuous because it stops there. But if you read the entire statement, it says not only it begins with that, but it ends with, if you have a lead service line, then you have a problem and you should call this number, or you should get on the website and find out if you, in fact, you have a lead service line. So what's been happening is that people have been putting out this story that we're saying the water is safe, period, point blank, without reading the rest of it, and residents do have the rest of that. And it doesn't account for the fact that, based on the lead and copper rule, we sent the notice home to every resident in the city that said we had lead exceedances. Nobody would know we had lead exceedances except that we tested the water and reported it. So it doesn't make any sense for us to put out one thing and then say something absolutely different later. It's also important to understand that everybody in the city does not have this problem. And it's important for us to make a distinction between those folks who do not live in those 14,000 homes that actually have the lead service lines and those who do not live in those homes. What has been happening is that has been blurred, I think purposefully and deliberately blurred, so that people in the city can believe that every time they turn on the water, there's lead coming out of it. And that's just absolutely false. It's not true. I mean, people who live next door to me don't have the
problem. When you say 14,000 homes, what's that in comparison to the overall number of homes in the city?
It's about 25% of the homes, the residents, the big buildings. And this characterization that, you know, the class of the people, most of the homeowners in Newark are middle class homeowners for the most part. The big buildings, where you're talking about projects or other buildings where the very low income folks live, don't even have lead service lines. So you're talking about an array of different people in the city who have this problem from many different nationalities and many different classes of folks across the city. Not only that, the people around the city of Newark, Bloomfield, Belleville, Hillside, are completely different demographic than the city of Newark altogether. So we just have to be clear on what exactly is happening here. And I think it's been very, very, very convoluted. Part of it because, you know, the lack of information, and part of it because we've been in this fight with NRDC. And I think that that has really taken our time as opposed to really trying to be clear about what the real problem is.
I wanted to ask you, lead problems in drinking water, especially in older cities in the Northeast and the Midwest, is not unusual. There was a history here, even before you became mayor, the previous mayor, Cory Booker,
right,
who is now running for president.
Right.
There's issues as to whether he did what he could. Apparently, there was a big corruption scandal in the water agency during his period of time. Six people went to prison. They were convicted as a result. What do you sense happened before you became mayor? And also, what did you do? What direct steps did you do once you got the report about the excess lead levels?
Well, I mean, I can't speak on what happened before I got there because I don't, you know, I'm not sure. Honestly, I'm not sure of what happened. I do know that there was a organization that was running the water department that we put out when I became the mayor. That we took the water system completely back from. But, you know, ultimately, you know, Newark, the reason that people even know that we have exceedances is because we test our own water. We test it and report it to the NJDEP. The minute the EPA told us that our corrosion control was, in fact, not working, we began giving out 39,000 filters that we pay for, by the way, most of them. The first exceedance we got in 2017 was about 11 to 12 homes out of 100. We began to go to those homes and figure out what was going on. So we get these exceedances. We deal with the homes that have the exceedances until we can find out what the actual problem is. We hired a firm to come in and look, CDM Smith, to come in and look at our water systems, who told us that the water system was fine, that they believe it may be the corrosion control. We had to then send it to the EPA, and they confirmed what CDM Smith said, that it was, in fact, the corrosion control inhibitor, and we began giving out filters from that. But even when we got our first exceedance, we lobbied the state to be able to get them to allow us to change people's lead service lines, because people forget the lead service line belongs to the homeowner, and the state would not allow us to change people's lead service lines with public money. So we had to get the legislature to change the law, which is what we were working on in 2017, to allow us to be able to change people's lines. And then they wanted us to change the people's lines and then charge them for it, right, which I thought was completely ridiculous. We changed the lines, and then we're going to charge the people for doing that. So we had to fight and say we didn't want to do that as well. So they allowed us to pay 90% and the homeowner to pay 10%. But with the new money, it allows us to pay for the whole thing. And you kind of bypass or disregard what the state policy is around making homeowners pay for it. So we're able to do that for every resident, even those who have lead service lines that are not affected.
And when you say corrosion inhibitor, I don't know if people understand that basically the lead pipes in many of these systems are decomposing so that some water systems put in chemicals.
All water systems
put in chemicals that basically inhibit the continued corrosion, but then that there were problems in terms of other chemicals that were added to the water that reduced the ability of this inhibitor to work?
Yeah, that's what people are saying. I mean, there's no real, like, evidence of it. You know, this is hypotheses that folks are coming up with, and I think that that needs to be studied as well. When did it happen and how and why? So other people will, because the sodium silicate we used is still on the EPA's website as something that you should use to inhibit corrosion from lead pipes into your water. It's still there, but no one knows why definitively it stopped working. And I think that that does need to be studied and get off of the kind of what we're guessing about so we can define what actually is the problem itself.
Mayor, last month we talked to Yvette Jordan, a teacher at Central High, where you were a principal before her. She's a resident of Newark South Ward. She commented on how you, Mayor Oz Baraka, have handled the Newark water crisis.
I think it's extremely important understanding who he is in our community. And he first and foremost is an activist. He was born and raised in Newark. He came back as a teacher, as an administrator, and was so revered in terms of what he was doing, in terms of young people, in terms of those who were really in need. So when he was approached with this and he said, no, everything is fine, really, it was almost a smack in the face of so many of us who supported him. So my husband and I even had him in our yard when he was campaigning and invited others over so he would come in and share his ideas. So he's somebody I supported, and in many ways, I still support. However, he really defied our public trust, and that hurt.
So that's the guest that Yvette Jordan. Will you meet with New Caucus or the NRDC or activists with the Newark Water Coalition to talk about the crisis?
I've never said I wouldn't meet with any of them. None of them ever tried to meet with me. The NRDC is like this huge behemoth, very petty bourgeois liberal organization who comes into our city and tells us that they want us to sign an MOU so they can oversee
our
water.
A memorandum of understanding.
Okay. So they could oversee our water system. Andrea Adewabli, where she rest in peace, said no. We have our own oversight. Basically, if they wanted to give us best practices, I don't think taking us to court and suing us would be the best way to do that. I mean, they could have knocked on the door and said, like any other constituent, and say, Mayor, we would like to meet and have a discussion about the water issue and how it's being handled or what we think would be the best way to do it. So now they're saying we're in court, which the first part of it, we actually won because they were trying to make us say that the entire water system was affected. And that, in fact, is not the case, which is why we were going back and forth. And what this young lady is saying on the television, I never told anybody that the water was fine altogether. I said that it was fine unless you have a lead service line, which is, in fact, the truth, right? Unless you have a lead service line.
And how do you know if you do?
Well, on the same document, it says call the water department, have your water tested. We've been testing water, testing children for years, right? So you can find out, or there's a website. You go to NewarkLeadServiceLine.com. You can type in your address. If you have a lead service line, your address pops up. You know, residents have been doing that for the last year and a half.
A lot of people are renters. The vast majority are renters. Is that right?
Yeah,
in Newark?
Absolutely. And they still can type in.
How do you get owners to participate in this? Do you have an issue with landlords?
We do have an issue with landlords. We've been going door to door. We have about 6,000 signatures that allow us to change people's lead service lines now, because the homeowner has to give us permission. But locally, we've passed a law, which they're going to vote on the final passage of it today, which allows us to go on people's property and change their lead service lines without their permission. So that takes care of the maybe 75% of the renters that's in the city who do not have a landlord who can come and sign a piece of paper for them. Right. But they can still type their address in and find out if that building or home that they live in actually has a lead service line.
Mayor, you've also come under criticism by some press accounts, I think somewhat unfairly, that you appointed somebody to be in charge of the water system who had a previous criminal conviction for drugs and who doesn't have the normal training to be in charge of a water system of this size. Your response to that, because obviously someone having been convicted of a crime in the past doesn't necessarily exclude them from ever having any kind of a decent job.
I call that the error of omission. In that same interview, Kareem Adeem pointed out seven different licenses that he has that qualifies him to operate a water system, licensed water manager, licensed sewer operator, sits on a state's lead and copper board, all these other kind of things outlined. But he was the second in charge of the water department under the previous water director who had passed away in the middle of this. She thought much of him to give him that title as the superintendent. I didn't fire him or dismiss him during that time. I allowed him to continue dealing with this process. I thought he was doing a great job. And, you know, I didn't look at his criminal record as a decider of whether I was going to replace him in the middle of this crisis. You know, based on what he was doing and his knowledge of what was happening, we decided to keep him on. So I didn't go out in the street and find him. He was already employed and he was doing a great job. And I'm glad he's there, in fact. And if he keeps doing this, he'll become the director.
I want to read from a letter Democratic Assemblyman Jamel Hawley wrote to you and New Jersey Governor Phil Murphy in August. Hawley's legislative district, neighbors, Newark. In the letter, he wrote, quote, "I'm pleading and suggesting to you, as the governor of this great state, that a state of emergency be called. This request comes on the backs of each human being in New Jersey that fears government has not appeared to show protection to them, nor has been transparent in this process that we together now face." What about calling a state of the emergency, and what would that mean?
Well, the only thing a state of emergency would have done at that point is probably try to get us money that we weren't sure we were going to get from the federal government. We're still waiting for money for Sandy now to get these homes
fixed. For Hurricane Sandy.
For Hurricane Sandy, right. So at the end of the day, particularly with the government in the in D.C., we wasn't sure what was going to happen with that. Declaring a state of emergency really didn't mean anything to us in the city of Newark. We were giving out water. We were giving out filters for a year and a half. We raised our own money, our own $120 million. We are going to announce today that we just, you know, settled a deal with the Port Authority, that longstanding fight with the Port Authority allowed us to raise an additional $155 million to pay the debt service that we're going to use it for. That's what we're going to use the money for, to pay some of the debt service down on the $120 million that we borrowed. To me, I think that was, you know, since the beginning of this, people have been using this as an opportunity, even grandstanding to some instances, right? My head has been down trying to figure out how to solve this problem from the very beginning, and that's what we've been doing.
And what about the federal government, the Trump administration? What's been their policy toward you and since this crisis emerged?
There has been none. I mean, there is no direct relationship. Nobody's offered us anything.
Have you asked for federal relief?
Sure. Sure. We wrote the letter. We wrote a letter to the White House a year and a half ago asking for assistance and help in infrastructure, which is what we're doing now.
Lot of money going to build a wall on the border.
Right.
Your thoughts?
Well, we should be using that for infrastructure, particularly around this water issue. I mean, this is hundreds of millions of dollars, billions across the country. I mean, Newark is not there are 70 cities in the state of New Jersey that are affected by this, in all 21 counties.
New Jersey governors mentioned supporting a millionaire's tax. Do you think this should be used to address infrastructure? Do you support this?
I absolutely support the millionaire's tax. It should be used to address a whole bunch of things, but this is one of them.
You're
yes.
holding a State of the Water town hall on Wednesday. Where is it being held, and what do you expect to come from that?
At the New Jersey Performing Arts Center, I think that, you know, we want to do this, want to update everybody on where we are, and to do talk about some of the things that people have on their mind, really address some of these things that I think have been unfair or just straight out not true. I think there's a lot of misinformation out on the street, and we just need to address it. And the more town halls we've done a series of them. We've been doing them for at least 2 years now on this issue. You know, the more contact we come in with people, the clearer they become, and they leave with a different sense of what's happening in their mind.
Well, Raz Baraka, we want to thank you for being with us. Mayor of Newark, New Jersey, elected May 2014. Juan Gonzalez will be speaking this Thursday, October 3rd, at the 60th anniversary of Claridad in San Juan, Puerto Rico. For details, visit our website at democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez for another edition of Democracy Now!